Here at Ferment Nation, we're asking the big questions, like, what is wine and why are you drinking it?
Wait, I got this. Let me help. We know that wine is a sucrose and fructose-rich liquid along with citric acid, tartaric acid, and succinic acid transformed by the metabolic processes in which Saccharomyces cerevisiae will aid and abet the splitting of carbon atoms which are rebonded as C2H6O or the ethyl alcohol compound.
No, my good man. You've got it all wrong. Wine is an expression of culture, reflective of mankind's traditional and historical connections to the land as expressed by terroir, guided by steadfast tenets of strength, valor, virility, and an unshakable belief in our own infallibility. Oh, yes, and wine is good to drink.
Well, I don't want to contradict those other gentlemen, but wine is fermented grape juice. I mean, okay, yeah, it's not just the grapes that give the flavors and the aromas. The yeast also add that. I mean, the kind of yeast you use, which yeast, it'll add some of these aromas and flavors. So yeasts are an interesting part of the story because these microscopic creatures consume sugar and excrete carbon dioxide, a little bit of heat, and eventually alcohol. They'll make so much alcohol, around 16% or so, that they basically suffocate on the alcohol and they die off. And so that's why you don't see wines above 16% alcohol or so, because the yeast can't do it. They've all died suffocating on their own excretion, which is really gross. The point is that some bugs are good and these yeasts are good. You add yeast to the squished up grape juice, we call that must. And in some cases, some wineries don't even add yeast because there's enough yeast in the air and in the winery to kick fermentation off all by itself. So yeast, they make dough rise. They are giving us bread. They're giving us all sorts of things and all sorts of flavors. And what we have to do with it once the dough rises is, of course, we bake this stuff. We finish it off and call it bread. Yeast help us all. Humans have harnessed yeasts for millennia to help them make food more edible, longer lasting, and more delicious. And like all these foods, wine doesn't exist without bugs. Some of these bugs are good, and some are bad, and some are very, very bad.
In a world where European vines are under attack, one man stands against an onslaught of alien destroyers. This time, it's microscopic.
Yes, it's true. Around 1860, this bug called Phylloxera traveled from the U.S. to France, and within a few decades, every vineyard in Europe was dead or dying. Who would stop this buggy pestilence? Only Thomas Volney Munson.
So why is T.V. Munson the hero of our story? Here's the deal. They built a statue to T.V. Munson. We like to call him T.V. because, well, we like TV, but they built a statue to him because he rescued the European wine industry, and he's the hero of this story. So he's born in Illinois, but he moves to Missouri because Missouri in the mid-19th century is like the center of the wine universe for North America. And he quickly figures out, okay, so there's this horrible disease going on in Europe, and this phylloxera bug is ravaging every vineyard in Europe, but the phylloxera bug comes from North America, and we have a bunch of vines that are growing healthy here, so he ships over North American vines to Europe. And what they do is they plant them there, phylloxera doesn't hurt them, and then they graft their favorite European vines onto these American roots. So instead of Chardonnay, you have Chardonnay on American roots. Instead of Cabernet, you have Cabernet on American roots. And Zinfandel and Merlot and on and on and on. What I said, that's what he does. And so everywhere in the world today, virtually, all vines are planted onto American roots, whether we're talking about Australia or South Africa or France or Spain or Italy or what have you. And that's how it's done today, except there's this guy just north of Kansas City. He's got a different idea.
The Munson varieties are a very specific set of grapes that came out of that breeding program, came out of that community of grape growers. We're drawing from a genetic pool that is separate from the European genetic pool from which most grape vines come. To have vines that come from a genetic stock that is already naturally well adapted to the heat and humidity that we get in the summer, and then also in the winter, the cold weather, just is really excellent. It means that we have an opportunity to make a real wine appropriate to this climate. Many of these varieties come out of the T.V. Munson catalog, and we're growing them at this stage at a very small scale to see how well they yield and how disease-resistant they are. T.V. Munson was one of the nurserymen who developed the rootstock that ultimately came into use in France and Europe and in the 21st century, really everywhere in the world.
Yep, same guy, Munson. He saves the day by creating all these new grapevines. Well, he dies in 1913, and he leaves behind about 100 or so of these new improved grapevines that are impervious to phylloxera and to Pierce's disease and all the other weird stuff that happens in this part of the world. And there's about 65 of them left a century later, 100 years later. Nobody's really been taking care of them, and they're still alive. Now, I gotta assure you, if this was Chardonnay or Cabernet, and nobody was taking care of them growing in Denison, Texas, probably wouldn't be alive. So this teaches us that these grapevines really probably belong and are at home in this area. So grapevines like America? America's great. I mean, you know, the grapevine, not the country. The country's fine too, but the grapevine is better. I mean, country's fine, but you know, grapevine, better. A lot of the grapevines that we grow around here are French-American hybrids. That's to say, they're crossings between French grapevines and American grapevines. You see, back when phylloxera struck, people were kind of desperate to do what they could. So they were, you know, poisoning the vines, burning vineyards down, spraying mustard gas, anything they could to try to get rid of phylloxera, until Munson saves the day. But the trick really is, for some people, was just to cross these two grapevines together, and then they'll handle things a lot better. And so we end up with grapevines like Vidal Blanc or Vignal or Chamberson. And these are the kind of grapevines that function really well here in the Midwest.